You love it like radiant diamonds bursting inside us. We cannot contain. You love will surely come find us like blazing wildfires. Singing your name.
Sing out, God of mercy.
God of mercy, sweet love of mine. I have surrendered to your design. And may this offering stretch across the skies. That these hallelujahs be more sin.
We sing to the God who always makes a way.
through the prison.
We were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by His grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise.
Sing again.
We were the beggars.
We'll be right back.
Yeah.
everybody said. And then you all may have a seat. That way. So this morning, we're going to have a couple people kind of come up and just share their stories, share their testimonies. And after that, if you feel led to come up here and, share a little bit of your story, just how God brought you here, or, what he's done in your life in the past, feel free. So first we're going to bring up Dave Churchill.
Morning.
Morning.
You know, when Rick asked me to do this yesterday, I'm like, I don't know what to talk about. My story is just like all yours, right? But what I want to talk about today, when I'm not up here giving a sermon, I'm usually up here talking about missions, and I'd like to still do that, because what missions did for me was it changed my life. It became not all about me. It became giving and serving others, which I think when we get out of ourselves and focus on other people, at least for me, it made me more joyful, all those fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, the other seven. Made me more patient. It made me have more goodness and faithfulness. And I think, that's what Jesus did his whole life. He focused his life on other people. He healed them. He raised them from the dead. And eventually, what he did for all of us, he lived and died and resurrected for us. His whole life was for someone else. And our whole lives should be about others. And for me, like I said, it changed my life. It brings me joy. It brings me peace. I remember, this was years ago when we went to the res. Tried to talk one of the guys into going. His name was Andy Belts. I don't know if you know Andy, but Andy's a great guy. And we were building a rec center. And he's like, "Babe, I have no skills. I can't go out there and build." I'm like, "Well, just come out and see what God has in store." And he did. And his gift was loving those Navajo children. And man, he did such a great job. And he loved them, and he went back to the res, and he went back to the res. This has always been a mission-oriented church. And, I think sometimes when, situations happen, first thing I used to think of is, man, how does that affect me? How does that affect my time? How does that affect my pocketbook? How does that affect me? And I think we need to think, how can we affect others? And the cool thing is, we think we're going to affect others and change people's lives, and the lives that end up changing are ours. I'm a much different person because of going to the reservation, going to El Salvador a dozen times, spending time in the prison. And lives are changed. I mean, if you're blessed enough to hear Angela up here a few weeks ago, Kairos, in the missions that we, Cobblestone does in Kairos, changed her life. We have an opportunity to be selfless, an opportunity to love people to God, and I believe that's our purpose, to love God and to love people to God. And like I said, it changed my life. If Marcel was here, she'd be saying amen. But when something good happens in your life, you want to share that experience with others. I think next time you're invited to help at IHN, to go to Jamaica, to go in the prison, because those are our three main ministries here. Don't just say no. Let God work on your soul and listen to God and allow Him to be the one to answer that question. And don't think, I don't have the time, I don't have the money, I don't have the skills, because God has given those skills and gifts to each of us. And if we don't share those gifts, that's sinful. So I just ask that next opportunity, and it doesn't even have to be here. It can be outside of Cobblestone. But when you have that opportunity to share the love of God, just make sure you do it. Because, like I said, it changed my life, and I am thankful for all the opportunities that I've had through Cobblestone to do missions. And I would invite you to share that same peace and joy and other seven fruit of the Spirit that He offers us. Thank you.
Hi, my name's Jessica Bookman. I've been at Cobblestone for about 3 years. I've had a problem with drugs and alcohol my whole life. I've been sober since April 18th, 2012. So I'm part of Alcoholics Anonymous, and that's really where I found God. I grew up in Southern Baptist Church in South Carolina, and it was very fear-based. I felt like people were really hypocritical and judgmental, and I didn't want to be a part of that. I grew up in a middle-class home, and I had really good parents. I had a lot of problems with panic attacks and anxiety disorder and depression. I was really, really smart, really nerdy. I was in the gifted program, and I always felt like I didn't fit in anywhere. So I felt like I could fit in if I started using drugs and alcohol. And from the very start, I started drinking alcoholically. I drank for a solution. I drank to not have fear. And what happened was it ended up controlling my life. So all through high school, I was on drugs and drinking. I had a full ride to college, and I dropped out after 6 months. I moved all over the place. I was homeless for about 6 months, trying to find. I thought that like maybe if I changed my friends that life would get better. I got to a point where I was like, I wanted to die. I remember praying to God when I was 19 years old to help me. And 2 weeks later, I found out I was pregnant. I lived in Florida at the time. And so that's where Aubriana came from. She's my Florida souvenir. but I ended up, that was the only way that I could get sober, and I see that God did that for me, because I hated myself, I hated my life, I hated who I was, and I loved that baby from the very time I found out I was pregnant. I went to rehab, and when I got out, I tried to be a good mom, but I only got sober for her, and I couldn't stay sober. So I ended up leaving. I love Aubrey with everything in my heart, but I couldn't stay sober for her. And so I left her with my parents a lot. I didn't come home. I would go out to dinner, and and tell my mom I was going out to dinner and leave her there and not come back for days. I couldn't be a good mom. I couldn't be a good person. And so I ended up, in 2010, I ended up getting in a really bad car accident. And I was drinking and doing cocaine and smoking pot, and I flipped my car 170 miles per hour out near Caesars Creek. And I was in the hospital. I had to go to jail. I've been to jail. I've been arrested 6 times. That's part of it when you're using. And, you know, I was in the hospital, and Aubrey was 7 at the time, and she looked at me and she said, "I don't want you to die, Mom." And that was the first time in my life that I actually thought, "I don't want to die either." And I ended up started going to AA as soon as I got out of jail, and it started changing my life. I had a really hard time opening up to people and talking about things, and I had a hard time making friends, especially with women. I didn't trust them. And so I ended up, after about a year and a half, I relapsed. I went out with some of my old friends and went to a concert, and started and did drugs with them. They were eating mushrooms, and then it was like, those aren't addictive, I can do that. And it just went back to the same thing. So on April 17th, I went out with a friend, and we ended up smoking crack all night. And I'd never done that before. That's one of those things that's like, I would never do that. So the next day, I was in college at the time, and I remember my friend Helen called me that I used to party with, and she said, she was like, "Are you still going to those AA meetings?" And I was like, "Yeah, but I smoked crack last night, so I probably should go to another one." So I ended up going with her. I met my AA sponsor at that meeting, and she likes going to concerts. We started going to concerts together, and she taught me how to have fun being sober. I didn't know what I liked to do. I loved kayaking, hiking, I love nature, I love gardening. It's been fun and an adventure trying to figure out what I like to do. Because when you're drinking and drugging, it's consumes your life. That's the only thing that matters. It's a very self-centered, bad place to be. And so that's my sobriety date, April 18th, 2012. And from there, I graduated college with honors for environmental engineering. I didn't think that I could get a job because of my record. And God has opened doors for me everywhere since I got sober. And my friend I ran into, she worked in an environmental lab, and she was like, "You can get a job there." And I went in for an interview, and the guy was like, "I see you have a marijuana record, and you've got DUIs and all this stuff, and I knew you would fit in here. We're all a bunch of hippies." And I was like, okay. Because I was like, I didn't even want to write that stuff down, but obviously they can look it up, you know? And I was just like, I couldn't believe it. My mom kept on being like, "You can go to college, you're smart, you can do this, apply for a job." And I'm like, nobody's going to hire me, you know? But I got that job, and then I ended up, today I work at P&G, I'm a chemist. I love what I do. I can't believe I work there. I just have a lot of gratitude. I mean, I've been homeless before. I just bought a beautiful new home last year. I got a brand new Subaru Outback. But the best part is not the material things, it's that I have peace in my heart. And I don't have to live the way that I used to. I don't have to hate myself. I hated myself for so long, even after I got sober, because I felt like I beat myself up over leaving my daughter with my family and not taking care of her, not being a good mom. That was probably the hardest part. But what I've learned from that is I can use my experience as an asset to help other people. And everything that I went through in my life, I'm able to use for good today. And God uses that in my life. And so what I do is I try to help other people that are struggling with alcohol and drugs. gives me an opportunity that a lot of people don't have. So I started in 2015. I go into Warren County Jail on Sunday nights, and I have AA meetings there for them. And it's been a huge blessing in my life. I help the ladies there get connected with jobs and places to stay and stuff when they leave there, so they don't have to go back into bad situations. And I've seen a lot of people get sober. Sometimes I don't see them get sober, but I know that I'm able to plant a seed in their life. And I can share the love of God with people that a lot of times have no love in their life. And, you know, it's been an amazing journey. Aubrey, I thought I screwed her up really bad, but she got a full ride to a private college, and she's going to be a physician's assistant. She wants to do women's healthcare to help women that are struggling and wants them to feel like they're not judged. She has a huge heart. What she's learned from me is that life's about helping other people, and I'm really proud of her. So I didn't screw up too bad. She's an amazing person, and she has the biggest heart and a non-judgmental attitude, and I couldn't be more proud of her. So I just want to share hope that, like, God loves all of us, and there's a plan, and you have a purpose for your life. And no matter what's happened to you, whether your problem's drugs and alcohol or anything that's happened in your life, you can use that to help other people. God can use you. And you know, I didn't think that was possible, but I see it, and I'm happy, joyous, and free today. So that's all I have. Thank you.
Anybody else have a little bit of their story they'd like to tell? Vicki, yeah.
Well, I figured I better hurry up because I talked myself out of it. But what I want to share is I'm hoping and I pray every day that they can see more Jesus and less of me. Because sometimes when I tell my story, it seems like just a self-pity thing. I grew up when I was 10. My dad died, and my mom had to go to work. She never worked. And I was the oldest, so I became the mom. And then at 16, I got pregnant and got married. And I really was so lost. I didn't know who I was at all, never did in my life. And I realized that I had to marry an alcoholic because that's the only person I felt comfortable with. And my life was so crazy. But God is such a restorer of relationships. I prayed for, started going to church when my daughter was in first grade and got saved. I was on the verge of committing suicide because my oldest son started getting in trouble, and I thought, I just live for my kids. So when he started getting in trouble, I figured, what's the use? And this preacher came by, and he asked me if he could keep coming by. And we started having Bible studies. And then he asked me one day, well, when are you going to accept the Lord? So I accepted him that day when he left, and then started going to church. And then things still kept going crazy. My husband got even crazier. I don't know if it was a threat to him or what it was. But I kept praying, and in 1990, he had been sober. He started going to AA, and he'd been sober for 4 years, and he had reversed the way he treated me. When I went to go get my GED before, he would say, you're too dumb, you can't do this, it's a waste of time. And then when I went to get it after he got sober, he's like, if anybody can do it, you can. And then in 1990, he had a seizure and passed away. But he had been going to church with me, and found where he had reading the Bible the night before he had the seizure, because he like woke up in the seizure. And I went to church and I said, God, I know you're not supposed to ask these things, but I need a sign. Am I going to be okay? And he said, he in heaven. And two people, you know, it was a Baptist church, so I believed. I said, I want to see somebody get saved. And two people went up to the altar. So to me, that was like, yes, yes. And then, I guess I should try to make this fast. My eldest son kept on his career with prison. And that was probably the hardest thing in my life, because I've lost two kids, and my dad, and my husband, and my mom. But people who live with alcoholics or live with people doing crazy stuff that you love, that's just as hard. And I could give testimony to that. God has made my life now so peaceful. And my daughter died in 2011, and you guys all know that because you were there for me. You were there to help me raise these girls and Tristan. God is, I found in her phone where he said, if God brings me to it, he'll bring me through it. And that was the hardest thing for me. Is she in heaven? Is she in heaven? But he kept pointing me to places of his promises in the Bible. So I really believe she is. And then in 2017, my oldest son was in prison and he found out he had cancer. And he got to come home 3 weeks before he died. And I was talking to him every day anyway on the phone, because when I found out he had cancer, I put more money on his books so he could call me more. And he had gotten into a prison ministry in prison. And he got saved, and he would say, Mom, I wanted to go off today. I remember what you said. It's just Satan. And he was a little, he was so amazing. He told me of a time when he was in Fraser, which is where they sent him, a place where they're dying. And he was really prejudiced. He was in that white supremacist group at prison before he got saved. And he said, Mom, you know, this old black guy, he started some crap with me here in Fraser. So the guy was in Fraser too. He said, and I said, man, no, I'm not going back. He said, you know what, man, Jesus loves you and so do I. So then every day he'd call me and he said, you know, that guy keeps watching me. So finally, I guess the guy said, will you read me that Bible you're reading? And so I guess he started reading the Bible and became good friends with him. And then when they were letting him out, he said, we got plenty of Bibles, right, Mom? I said, yeah. I said, why, you want to give your Bible to that guy? He said, yeah. So he gets out, he comes home, and he's in hospice. And I get to see what a good man he is, how much he's changed. Because everybody walked through that door to visit him, he said, you know, Jesus loves you. You know, he couldn't talk enough about Jesus. And this is due to a prison ministry, taking the time to let him get to know Jesus. And I found this Vicks. I said, did hospice give you this? He said, no, it was that guy. You know, I'm keeping that Vicks for the rest of my life. It just reminds me of that. And then he did pass. And, but I know he's in heaven. And I decided to join Kairos because of Marcella. And I got to go on one thing, and then COVID put a stop to it. And I did it to give back for my son. But man, I got way more than I could ever give. I had a blast. I mean, Maybe it's because it's my calling, I don't know, but it was, I can't wait till COVID gets back enough so we can get back in, because I've never had so much fun in my life. And God has just, he restored all my relationships. And I just can't praise him enough. And the peace I have now, I mean, there's no craziness going on. And I sit outside, I live in the country a little bit, and listen to birds and remember my grandma, you know, the bob whites and the pretty birds and stuff like that. But God has been so good to me. And I'm getting ready to be a great grandma. So it's just the best is yet to come. Everything that Bible says is true.
Anybody else have a little bit of a story they'd like to tell? Yes, go ahead.
Already on? I don't have a life story like other people have, but I've done lots of different careers and different careers in my life. I started out in criminal justice, and then God called me into teaching, and I taught junior high students, which kind of not much different than criminal justice, but same thing, you know, same kind of patients, same kind of problems. And then I went back into the field of criminal justice where I'm now. But the story I have to tell is when I was a teacher of these junior high students, and it's a story of prayer. So hopefully you can get a blessing from it. I sure did. So when I was teaching junior high, we had a teacher that was one of our English teachers that was pregnant. It was a surprise pregnancy, so if anybody's had like their youngest be 10 or 12 and then find out they're having a baby, she was a little shocked because they weren't planning on having any more children. But the students were real excited, you know, because she was gonna have the baby and it was gonna happen over Christmas break. And so they left for Christmas break, and when they came back from Christmas break, we as teachers had to tell them that she did have her baby, but she had suffered aneurysm, a hemorrhage, blood clot from the delivery, and was in a coma and on life support. So she was not doing well, and they did not think she was going to make it. So I hope I can get through the story without crying to her. So the students were really, of course, they were really upset, and a couple weeks went by, and this isn't a Christian school, so it was a blessing because we were able to start every class with prayer, and we would pray for her. And, you know, the students would listen to us teachers pray. And finally the day came that her husband informed us that they were going to take her off life support. And we're going to just, you know, let her go. And so they were going to do that in the next day or so. And he was just going to give time to bring his kids in so they could say goodbye to the mother the next day. Well, that day when the students came in, I don't know why, but I just felt like we needed to pray. So I told the other teachers, let's just get the students together. It's probably about 80 to 100 students. And let's just go in the gym, and we'll just lead in prayer as teachers. And if any kid wants to pray, they can. You know, junior high kids aren't big at praying in front of each other. And even though it's a Christian school, if you all know anything about Christian schools, I mean, 50% of the kids or more are not Christians, and a lot of them are not from Christian homes. They're just going there because it's a private school, but it's a ministry. So we just thought we would start praying, and I thought, well, we'll pray for like 20 minutes, maybe 30 minutes, and then we'll go back to class. So we as teachers started praying. One of us would pray, and then we did have some students, a student would pray, and then a teacher would pray, and we were just supplicating to God that he would have his will and that he would heal her if it was his will. And, you know, usually as a teacher, you're leading everything, and you feel like, you know, you're the one that's praying. Well, God took control of that prayer, and the students just started praying, and I mean, one after another, they just kept praying and praying, and students that you would not even think would ever pray out loud in front of their peers started praying, and what was supposed to be a half an hour prayer at the most turned into over 2 hours of my just sitting back as teachers. We just sat back and let God take control and let the Holy Spirit take control of all those kids just supplicating their heart out to God, and it was just this incredible moment. I've never ever been in a prayer moment before that or since then of a group of Christians praying where I felt the Holy Spirit move like he did with those kids. And just all of them just pouring their hearts to God and supplicating on behalf of all the teacher that they loved. So we had to end the prayer. We had to make them stop because they had to get on the bus and go home. So we couldn't just keep going. But I don't know how long they would have prayed. I would have just let them pray forever if it was my choice. Because that was not just a movement of God on behalf of this teacher, but that was these students learning how important. And when God gets a hold of your heart, you aren't going to be afraid to pray in front of people. You know? And for those of us that get a little intimidated to pray in front of people, if God's on your heart and that Holy Spirit gets a hold of you, you're going to pray. And that's what they were doing. And the next day or so, their husband was planning to bring the kids in, and he did. He brought his kids in to see his wife and say goodbye. And the youngest one, just I think he grabbed her hand or did something, and he said, "Mommy, you need to open your eyes." And she opened her eyes, and she woke up. So she is a mom today. So I think that if we underestimate the power of prayer, that, you know, we can do and do and do, but sometimes we just need to get on our knees, and sometimes we just need to pray. And if you don't think your kids can pray, and if you don't think kids can move mountains through prayer, I can tell you that kids can pray. And the Holy Spirit can work, not just in us, but through our children. And God listens to their prayers as much as he does ours.
Boy, what a powerful man, a powerful God we serve.
Amen.
You know, I have no story. I'm just thankful for Dave, Sherry, Jessica, every one of y'all that came up and, you know, told a story. You know, it's so refreshing. You know, I'm thankful for Kim, who came in here today. You gave me a hug, and we all go through our battles. I've seen you when you're struggling. It's so nice to see people coming here, and maybe one week is a bad week, but the next week it's great. But just have the ability to, first of all, trust in God. You know, I mean, we, so many times we want to run to anybody but God. And that should be the first person we run to every time. Our Father. You know, I think Bill. Bill got me here. Let me tell you right now. I love you, brother. You've been good to me. You've been generous. You are definitely a man of God. That's all I can say. You're my brother. And I just, you know, I just want to just thank everybody. Man, this is my home. I love it. I have no problem getting up on Sunday, you know. It's one of the only days I look forward to getting up to. Sunday, man. Sunday. I thank you for my wife. Michelle, that's where I get what I get from. My wife, man, she is awesome. My kids, love them to death. They're not here, but well, we've been blessed. We've been blessed. And that's what I want to say. And like I said, I love all y'all. Thank you.